to be successful, you've got to be in the moment in whatever it is you're doing. There's no point trying to be multiple things to multiple people at the same time, because you'll fail at everything. I didn't want to be that mum who was at the park pushing the kid with one hand on the swing while doing my emails on my phone in the other one. I didn't want to be that person. And so I acknowledge and accept that I maybe don't have as much free time with my kids as what other parents have. But what I don't have in quantity, I make up for in quality. So, you know, things like I'm really diligent about leaving work on time and getting home and having them a couple of hours with the kids on a night. And if they want me to go in the bath with them or whatever, I'll just do it. I'm one of them mums whereby the answer is yes, now what's the question? And I'll do anything those kids want to make sure that the time they have with me, they have the best time, so that when they're not with me and I still know they're having a great time with their grandparents or with their dad or whatever it is, I don't pine after what I can't have. I accept that at that point, I'm on TV or I'm in a business meeting or I've had to travel somewhere and I'm giving work 110% of my attention. Because and I've done it before, you know, I've been away from home and, you know, you spend ages sitting flicking through photos and then you start feeling guilty that you weren't there for something or whatever. And the guilt riddles you. You know, I remember missing sports day one year. And I was distraught that I wasn't going to be there to cheer them, you know, as they ran over the finish line. But Simon was there and the grandparents were there. So the kids still had a great time. And I just thought, right, I can't be there for sports day. Well, I'll definitely be there for the nativity this year. And so instead of focusing on what I missed out on, I congratulate myself on what I had been able to do. And I think that's the thing. Don't focus on the negatives, focus on the positives. I think it's everything I thought it would be and loads more. You know, I love it. My boys are 4 and 7 now, and I've got a little niece as well who's coming up too. And we're big family people, so I spend a load of time. I mean, I always spent a lot of time with my mum, but I spend even more time now with my parents, with my in-laws. You know, I would never hang out with my in-laws. Now I choose to go and hang out with my in-laws because I enjoy spending time with them, because I look at how I've just made their life. I think one of the best things about parenthood is you get to make their lives of the grandparents and give them something incredible. And I just look at how wonderful our family is and think, yes, you know, I've been a big part in making all of that happen. So, yeah, I love it. I love that it's like unconditional love. Those kids have unconditional love for me. And, you know, I quite often, like I lie in bed with them on a night and I think, oh God, one day you're going to be all grown up and, you know, you're not going to want to hang out with me anymore. So I'm just going to make the most of this time now. But I love that they need you for everything, you know, and I am shaping the individuals they become, as it was. So it really means a lot to me to keep those kids grounded. And it's hard because I want to give them everything I didn't have. And I have the money and the means and the wherewithal to give them everything. But giving them material things isn't going to make them a better person. So, you know, prime example, a couple of years ago, Simon's mum and dad wanted to take them to Thomasland for the weekend. And they had the best time and the kids were buzzing. And they wanted to go back to Thomasland. And I wanted to have that experience of going to Thomasland with them. So I wanted to just book up and take them a few weeks later. And Simon wouldn't let me. And he said, no, that's not an everyday thing. Like that is a treat. That's a once a year thing. And they've been. So they've had that experience. I don't want them to think that this is a normal thing that kids do all the time. And I know it was really important for them to have that, for it to be special and not to become everyday. But then it meant that I missed out. And I think it's that constantly doing what's right, not what's always the most fun or the thing that I can do. I mean, when I was young, my parents really didn't have much money at all. And, you know, it would always be camping holidays. And, you know, I was always the kid at school with the Adidas 4-stripe tracksuit bottoms. And, you know, my school bag was from the car boot sale. And, you know, and it didn't affect me growing up. And so I want my kids to grow up like I did, appreciating things and appreciating the value of money. And then I had to work for something to earn it, didn't just get it given. So I definitely, and Simon was exactly the same. We both came from very working class families. And so we aren't on different pages about this. We are absolutely on the same page of how we want our kids to grow up. So even if, like I said, it's, And it, you know, prime example, Simon and I, if we like to go on holiday, if we go just the two of us, we'll go somewhere quite expensive, nice posh hotel or whatever. If we're going with the kids, we won't, because I don't want the kids to think that that's what a regular holiday looks like. So, you know, last weekend I took the kids to Haven and stayed in my friend's caravan, because that's what we would have done when we were kids. And the kids had the best time. And it just, you know, it shows me, it doesn't have to be expensive, materialistic things. It's just making memories with the family. So I would say it's when I give it to other working mums. And I always say to them, you know, it's all about being present in the moment and not letting mum guilt creep in. Mum guilt is the one absolute killer, and it just eats away at you, but it's within our control. So I just think if you want to be everything, you want to have a successful career and be a successful mum, it's within your gift to do that, but you will only achieve that if you build yourself up and be positive about what you're achieving, not riddle yourself with guilt about things that you're missing out on. Yeah, and I know loads of people who've started businesses during lockdown, loads of mums, furloughpreneurship they call it, isn't it? So where people have like had that little bit of a security blanket and taken the opportunity to start a business. And all I would say is just remember why you've started the business. And if you've started the business because you want to be able to work flexibly around the family and have that enjoyment, don't then all of a sudden compromise everything that you've got with the family to give it to the business, because you'll look back on that time and resent it. And I think that's the biggest thing. If you've made that leap and you've done it so that you can drop the kids off and pick them up from school, or you can therefore be able to, you know, have a little bit of time during the day, work on an evening, just always remember that. Because I remember, you know, I started my business before I had a family, which meant I could give the business 110% of my energy all the time. I just lived to work all the time. But then when I had the family, I had to wind that back a little bit, and I had to work less. And I wanted to work less because I just thought, remember why I wanted to start the business in the first place, so that I could have the business and the family and have it both. So don't compromise. Don't ever want to look back when the kids are older and think, I missed out on so much when they were little because of the business. Because really, was that worth it? I remember we had a watch party for the first episode going out. And so that's the first time they'd seen it, because we hadn't seen any of the rushes, any of the clips, nothing. So we had a party. We had all of our friends, family and everything round. And I remember we were in the cricket club, and it was on in the big screen. And I remember our Oliver just sitting watching it, couldn't quite get his head around it. And then afterwards, he came over and said to us, well, that wasn't really Dragon's Den, Mammy, was it? I said, well, what do you mean? He said, well, it's not a den, is it not? It's just a room, and they're not really dragons. And I think in his head, he probably thought I was getting dressed up as a dragon and sitting in a cave somewhere, because I'd said I was going on Dragon's Den. So, you know, as a, what was he, five at the time? I can understand that as a five-year-old, that's probably what you thought it was going to be. So, yes, I think I've just been a huge disappointment to the kids from the Dragon's Den perspective. It's really easy, and I did it. I ended up buying a load of rubbish that I didn't really need just because I saw other people had them. So when we get parenting products come in the den, which we get quite a lot, I really look at it and give it the once over and think, is this a gimmick or is this actually making my life better? And it wasn't that long ago that I had really young kids or a baby or whatever, and we do get a lot of products in, and I look at it and I think, it might look good, but it's a gimmick. And I think that's what I have sometimes over the other dragons. You know, I've been there and done that, walk the walk, so I can appreciate what it's like. Whether it's, we get a lot of like birthing products and you know, pregnancy products. So I think in that space, it definitely gives me a USP that I can draw on the personal experiences. Interestingly, the couple that have really stood out at me are the ones that have been in the kind of parenting space. So you shouldn't have favorites. It's like children. I haven't got any favorites, but the two that I've really enjoyed working with a lot this series are my Will Saw Books guys and Easy Tots, Helen from Easy Tots. So Will Saw Books are the plantable children's books. And because I've got kids who are right at that age, and I think it's really, really important that kids understand where their food comes from. Our little Charlie, my four-year-old, I got a note from the teacher one day, and he said, we've been learning about where our food comes from this week. he said, and Charlie knew all about it. Not like one of the other kids in the class who we said, where did milk come from? And he said, the Tesco van. Whereas our Charlie knows all about it because my mum and dad, they took an allotment when I had the kids because they knew I didn't have the time to run an allotment, but they wanted the kids to see what raising the hens was like and where our eggs came from and growing all of the different the vegetables that we would eat. So the kids really understand and love that. So when I saw this, you know, plantable children's books, I just thought this is brilliant because for all I've instilled that into my kids, not all kids have that benefit. And what a brilliant present that like a grandparent could buy or something. And the idea is you read the book, so you'll read all about the carrot and it's not like, it doesn't feel educational, it feels like a story. And then once you get to the end of it, you cut off the last page in the book, the cover, and you plant it. And a few days later, because kids are really, they like to see immediate. So it's literally a few days later, the seeds will start growing. And I just thought it's absolutely genius and the kids have loved it. So that's the first one. And then the other one that I was quite excited about, they're called Easy Tots. And what really impressed me was Helen was a fantastic entrepreneur, really driven, understands the market, the niche in the market, where she's going after it. And she developed a great product and she developed it based on consumer feedback and research and understanding that market. So it's a tray for babies. And you know, I know when I was younger and I had our child, well, both the kids, you've all got them IKEA high chairs, but the food goes all over, the pots are going on the floor, everything. And this is a special cup and it's got like a suction, it's a mat all molded with suction underneath. So it sticks to that mat and the kids or the toddlers can't get it up. So it keeps all the food organized in front of them and they eat from it. And then when you're ready to go, you just put the lid on and you pack it into your bag. So I just love the product. And it took me right back to when I was a mum and you'd see one of the other mums with one of the latest gadgets and you'd all have to have it. So I thought she's done a brilliant job of, you know, finding a niche within her market. So yes, so by the end of last series, I felt like I was in the baby space. I remember turning to Tuka one day and saying, hey, you, we'll be taking you on in the baby space now.